Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to talk about these shielded ferrises, as I like to call them, the safe rust crabs, or I don't know. I'm still working on the name. Anyway, these are GLTF ferrises that are from another project that I'll mention later. And these spheres are also a separate GLTF export from Blender that have a custom Blender, or not a custom Blender material, but a custom Bevy material using the new Bevy 0.8 material APIs to apply both a vertex shader and a material shader that handles all of the colors that make these look like the kinds of bubbles you might blow as a child with the soap bubbles kind of thing, right? And then the hexagons inside of them, you can see on in 4K, but you can't see if they're a little bit, 1080p-ish or lower resolutions or further away. So I think that I'm actually going to change that and make those hexagons bigger at some point. But we've got this vertex displacement that starts on one end of the sphere and goes to the other side. And yeah, we're going to dig into this because I'm super excited. And this is the culmination of about a week's worth of work, at least. So we'll leave that in the corner there. And then we'll go over the Rust code first, and we'll go over the shader code second, as usual. In this case, we've got a background color that we don't really see because we've got a floor here. We've got the default plugins for our Bevy application. We've got the shader utils plugin, which adds all of the custom kind of helper functions that I've added to WGSL. That is a library that is also in this workspace in this libs Bevy shader utils crate, if you are interested in that. I've added one new function there that we'll talk about later. We add the custom material using the material plugin. We add a startup system. We update the time for all of the custom materials. We modify the GLTF scenes to apply the new materials, and then we animate the light directions. So that's why we see this global illumination or this global light moving around in a circle. We set up our scene with some ambient light. The ambient light is orange red, but it could be anything, whatever color. It could be as bright as we want, doesn't matter. We add this directional light, which is kind of our global illumination that's happening here. That's what turns around in a circle. And then we've got the ground plane. The ground plane is interesting because we've got this plane that's about 100 units or whatever big in each direction. That uses a standard material with a color of white. So we could change this to something else. Maybe a darker color would be more interesting. But we use these albedo and normal maps on that concrete. So we get a little bit of bumps in this, even though there aren't any actual bumps there. And then that's placed right below all these spheres. So it cuts off kind of the bottom of the sphere and places right below each of the ferrises. The next thing we do is load in the two GLTF files. In this case, they're GLB files. GLB being the binary format of GLTF. The first one is the hex sphere 5 subdivisions. And then the second one is the Ferris 3D V1.0, which comes from a separate project that, again, I'll mention and I'll link to at the bottom in the description. We set the number of ferrises we want. This is actually going to be 20 times 20 ferrises. So 4YX in 0 to num ferrises. This is a range if you've never seen that in Rust. Cartesian product with the same range will give us basically if we have an XY grid of 0 to 20 in one direction and 0 to 20 in the other direction, Cartesian product for both of those ranges gives us every point in that grid. So we get 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, etc., etc. So using those values, we offset them negatively because we want them to go to the left and away from the camera, which are both negative directions for X and for Z. We multiply that by the space that we want them to take up, so 2.5 for each of them. And then I offset that by 5 in the X and 2.5 in the Z. I should rename this to Z because it's Z and not Y. And then we spawn a shielded ferris at that location with the shield GLTF scene and the ferris GLTF scene at that transform. This is a custom command that I wrote that we'll go over later. It is not super interesting. It's just inserting both of these, basically. Then we spawn our camera 3D bundle. Our camera 3D bundle in this case doesn't move, so this is the only view that we get, but we could make it move. We have made it move in other ones. For updating the time, we get the database of custom materials and we get the current time using res time. We don't use something that's outside of Bevy. We use Bevy's concept of time. And then we iterate over all the custom materials and we update the time field on them. Now, this is going to change in the future. There's an open PR to add time as a global into the WGSL file. So we actually won't even need to write this system in the future. But as I understand it, this is also kind of an inefficient way, even though it is the intended way to update these values. And that will also change in the future. So if you look at this as kind of a stress test, if we go up to like 2,500 ferrises or something, this could be one of the places that we are actually causing a slowdown. Although 2,500 ferrises is quite a lot. And then for our custom material, we have to implement material. Our fragment shader is custom material.wgsl. Our vertex shader is vertex shader.wgsl. Our alpha mode is blend for the sphere, but not for ferris. And then we specialize this pipeline. I actually took this out. This is the cull mode that I was setting here. The cull mode means should we render the back side of this sphere or not? The things that aren't facing, say, the camera. And I chose to take that out because when I was talking with Griffin about the Fresnel, they brought up that it looks actually nicer and works better if we just take all of the backside off. So instead of including that backside and trying to get it to work, I've chosen to remove it. So then we get our custom material. Our custom material in this case takes the time, which we just talked about. It also takes the color or a color, which we aren't currently using. And then these two things, alpha mode and color texture. I think color texture we aren't using. I should remove that. Our mod scene system queries for all the spheres that we haven't seen yet. So this isn't just spheres though. When we query for this, we're querying for entities that have a mesh handle and a name, which is going to be basically all of the meshes in our GLTF scene. So for example, this ferris model has a left claw, a right claw, a couple of legs, and the body. And all of those come back in this query. I haven't figured out a way to make this query smaller or to like restrict it in that way, but we can filter that out here. And I do when we go for sphere and spheres dot iter, and then I filter out for only the ones that are named icosphere, which is what this sphere happens to be called from Blender. It looks like I've left a stray commands.entity here. So whatever, just ignore that line. And then we get the meshes for sphere.1, which is going to be our icosphere mesh. We do the vertex debugging colors that I like to do. I've explained it a couple times before, but basically we're getting the positions as a vec3 of float 32s for all of the vertices in the mesh. And then we use those positions as the colors in our vertices. And then we set the mesh attribute colors attribute on that mesh. And this will pass in these colors as vertex colors into our vertex shader. Again, I just like to do this for debugging purposes. We actually are using it right now. So these colors here are coming from this, but you know, you don't have to do this part if you don't want it. Then we add our custom material to the custom materials database, the assets database. In this case, we set some stuff. None of this really matters except for the alpha mode blend because the time gets overwritten and I don't think we're using the color or the color texture right now. Then we get the entity for the sphere itself and we remove the standard material. Then we insert our custom material. This is the swap out that happens. So when the GLTF scene is loaded for the sphere happens to be the only thing in the scene, but we still need to swap out the default standard material that the sphere is rendered with our custom material that we want to apply to that sphere. I'm sure there's a better way to do this, but I haven't found a widely used system of, say, tagging materials and automatically swapping them out in Bevy. If you have a suggestion, let me know. I would love a better way to do this. Then we do the entity once again, and we insert inserted, and we insert not shadowcaster. Not shadowcaster is super important because you can see as the light goes around these ferrises, they're casting shadows on the ground. This sphere can also cast shadows on ferris itself. So if we let the sphere cast shadows, what we end up with is ferris is just always in shadow because it's completely encapsulated by this sphere. So we need the not shadowcaster component to prevent it from casting shadows. And the inserted component right here is something that we are filtering our query by. So we only operate on each of these once. This is animating the light direction, which we've talked about in other videos, so I won't cover. And then we get to our custom command here. In this case, I've made a struct called spawn shielded ferris with a transform the shield and the ferris. This is a handle to a scene. So theoretically, we could swap out the shield type for each of these ferrises or randomize it somehow, which would be kind of cool. because we could randomize, say, like the size of the ferris and the size of the shield and place them all over. We have to impl command for that struct if we want it to actually work. And then we get to access everything via world instead of accessing it via commands. But otherwise, it's all the same. We insert a scene bundle with the shield and the transform, and then the ferris and the transform. And that's how we get this scene. So this vertex shader has actually not changed since we went over the actual like pulsing animation that happens. So this code right here, I will link to in the description for the explanation for that, because I've already covered it in another video. But suffice it to say that we keep that diff around and we pass it down to the fragment shader so that we can use it to recolor that area as this displacement happens, which leaves us with the fragment shader. And the fragment shader, so what's interesting here is that we use simplex noise a little bit, and I've created a new function called mock Fresnel. The mock Fresnel function is the exact same function that I talk about in the Fresnel video, which I'll also link below if you want more details on that. But that's what gives us this nice bubble effect around our ferris instead of the whole sphere, because the sphere actually exists in front of ferris, right? So that's what gives us this nice border that we can modify if we want to. I think I've set up hot reloading actually. So maybe I will show that here if this will work. If I save that, no, I don't think I've set up hot loading. Okay, well, that's fine. We can do that right now. So I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna grab these asset server settings from the Fresnel effect video, and I'm gonna bring that down into our shield spheres, and I'm gonna kill that and restart it. And asset server settings isn't in yet, so we'll bring that into scope using Rust Analyzer, which is super amazing. I love not having to scroll up to bring things into scope. And then we have our ferris running here. So with that being there, our mock Fresnel function should update now when I save this. So now we get this like kind of really nice interactive bit of like shader updating. So we get as much as we want here. I could make these more intense. One thing that is really interesting is if I increase the power, it is more intense, but it also gets more stark in the transition. So I get to do kind of whatever I want to here. So we can see some nice thick shields here, or we can go back to what we had before. If I put this up to 3 and I put this up to, let's say, 4, then I can get some pretty intense borders going on here as well. So maybe we leave it like that. That's kind of a nice intense border that still retains some of the transparency, but is also pretty stark of a transition, actually, now that I think about it. So maybe we do something like that. Anyway, this is the mock Fresnel function. This mock Fresnel function is exactly the Fresnel implementation that we talk about in the Fresnel video that I'll link again. So we pass in the view world position XYZ. We pass in the world position of the fragment that we are looking at. Again, XYZ. We pass in the world normal of the fragment that we're looking at, and we pass in the power that we want to apply, or that we want to modify the output with, and we pass in the thing that we want to multiply the end value with as well. So what we end up with here is this Fresnel is calculating the angle difference between the fragment normal, which is pointing out from the sphere through the center of the fragment, and the view vector, which is the fragment's to camera vector. And we get the angle between those two, which if it's pointing directly at the camera is nothing. If it's pointing kind of on the side, on the edge here, is going to be larger. And we use that to determine whether we should apply the Fresnel effect or not. So now I get to use Fresnel all over the place without having to retype all of that code, which I'm super excited about. I actually really like that Bevy added some modularity on top of the WGSL scripts like this. So at the top here, we get simplex noise. This is a VEC3. Let me get rid of that a little bit. In this case, we take the XY world normals. I multiply by 400 for no real reason. And I use time as well, so it updates. That gives me a noise value. Right now, I don't think I'm actually using the noise value, but the way that I might use it is something like this. I could multiply the alpha value that we're using by the noise, and then we would get this like significantly different output on the side. So if we were gonna do something like this, maybe we would make it a little bit wider so that we could get a varied value along the area that we were actually applying the Fresnel, but the interior where we're not applying the Fresnel and Fresnel is 0 basically still won't show. So I haven't decided what I'm doing with that yet, but we do have the noise there. And let me reset that as well. So we've got the noise. We've got the highlight. The highlight is this wave that comes around. So the wave is something that we really only see in the places where the finale is applied. That doesn't necessarily need to be true, but it is right now. So we mix the world normal, which is the red, green, yellow, red around here. These are the colors that are effectively the world normal vector position translated directly to an RGB color. So we've got an XYZ position. We're literally just using those as RGB, and that's why we get this colorful sphere. Then we're mixing that with this color, which I think is a pink. Yeah, if you look at this going around, it is actually a pink. And we modulate that by the highlight. So we're deciding whether we use the world normal color or the VEC3 here, the pink color, based on whether highlight is 0 or 1. So if it's at 0.5, we use an equal percentage of each of them. If it's at 0, we use all world normal. If it's at 1, we use all of this pink color, which is how we get the wave to actually have a different color than everything else. And that's basically it. I've also smooth stepped the Fresnel value a little bit so that we get a little bit of a different effect. That's kind of a creative choice. That doesn't have to be there. If I don't do that, it looks more like this. It's not that big of a difference, but I decided I wanted it. So that's why it's there. So yeah, I'm actually looking forward to using this mock Fresnel function quite a bit more. If I look at the code for that, you can see that I've loaded the shader in the mock Fresnel value. If we go to the mock Fresnel.wgsl, it is the same function that we used from the Fresnel video, including all of the comments. I left those all in here because I felt like they were super useful, especially if anybody's going to come and use this code for any reason. So that's why it's sitting in here like this. I haven't published a new version of the crate for 0.8 yet, but I'm about to. So if you want to check it out, you could totally check that out. I'll leave another link in the description. And that's about it. So I'm super excited about this because this is kind of like what I've been working towards for about a week now, maybe 2 weeks. I don't know. When was our first shield sphere video? We now have the Fresnel effect, which allows us to see inside of the sphere. We've got the hexagons and the effect going around the shield. So now we can kind of just choose what kind of effects we want to apply, and we could create a bunch of different spheres. Now, the one thing that we don't have here still, you'll notice, is the depth prepass, which is a PR that I'm still working on. The depth prepass will allow us to, well, I'll explain it in a future video, but basically this line here that goes along the ground, we want to mark that as well in the same way that we have the sphere itself marked all the way around. So instead of getting basically no color where the sphere intersects with the ground, I would love to see that have the same kind of gradient in from that edge. And we can do that with a depth prepass. Look forward to that video. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments as usual. And otherwise, happy ferrousing.